Hello, welcome back to Go and Walkabout. It's another Flutter episode, and today we continue with the implementation of the flagging. We're going to extend it with hiding posts, trips, and users. For App Store approval, flagging alone is not enough. Since we're dealing with user-generated content, we also need to make sure that we can hide, block users if we don't like their behavior, and or we need to be able to hide posts and trips. So that's what I'm going to implement today. Now, the first thing I had to do was changing a little bit of the business logic. I'll show you that here. So we saw before we had the flagging action sheet, and in the previous episode, we had the flagging options defined within this piece of code in the user interface. Now, that is not where it belongs. It should go to the backend. So I moved it into the block. As you can see here, we have the trip options. So the trip actions that we can do. Those are the flagging options as we had before. Now, this little refactor was necessary to make it possible to do the other things that I wanted to do. Because as part of those actions, you know, the list with the flagging options need to be extended with the possibility to also hide a user, block a user, hide a trip or a post. So that's what I could implement now quite easily in the block on the backend. So for that, I'll just switch to some other branch I have here of my code. And now we see here the flagging options. So we still see the flagging actions, and I extended it a little bit so that it not only contains, let's say, the text of the action, but also the function to be executed when it is selected. So we have the add flag function, as we saw that in the previous episode. But I also extended it. So if the post is not null, means we trigger the action from the post, we also add an action hide this post, and we add an action block a particular user, so actually the user of the post, with the appropriate actions, with the hide post action and the hide user action. Now, if the post is null, that means we trigger this from a trip. We do it a little bit different because we add hide this trip and we add the user from the trip. So we block the trip, the user. That to make a little bit of a distinction. In the current version, the post user is always the same as the trip user. But in a future version where I will allow collaboration of people, you might have multiple people posting within the same trip. And that's what I already take into account. Now, if we have this function, we can go a little bit further because now it is about hiding and everything of the post. And the way I did that is, let's go into this function and then we can see it the easiest. In the block, we have a hide post function and that is actually dealing with it. And it's best shown actually with a demo. So let's first go and run this so we can see it actually running on the simulator. And then I'll also show you what happens in the data store to give you a little bit better understanding how I implemented this functionality. Now, the first thing you need to realize that this piece of functionality is something that is only used occasionally. It's not that you're going to block thousands of users or anything. And I needed to store it somewhere efficiently. So what I did, I chose to store the blocked users, trips and posts, or hidden, whatever you want to call it, inside the user record. Now let's get the simulator up and running. We know this, it is the same trip, and let's go into this trip and now start blocking this first post. So we can click this. Now we see we had the flagging options that we saw before, but we also have the hide post and the block of the particular user that is that created this post. And that is what I just added and what you just saw. So let's go and hide this post. Now we see it disappearing from the user interface. It's hidden. So the functionality is working. But what happened? And it is better to see if we go here, because this is the user in question. And we now have a hidden post and an ID of the post that is hidden. So let's do the second one. That's the one we do here. We say hide this particular post and see what happens. We add an additional ID. And that is all there is to it. So every time when we hide something, I write an ID to this particular section. Now this is for post, but for a trip it is exactly the same. So if we would go here and I would hide this trip, yeah, it will also create a new record here with the trip is hidden. And we see also here in the user interface that the trip has disappeared. Now, there's still something I need to complete, because of course, when you hide the whole trip, you also want to have the option to navigate back, and that ain't working at the moment. And this list isn't refreshed yet, so I still have to manually refresh it in order to make it disappear. But this gives you an idea of how the functionality is working and how I store the information about hiding. And if I hide a user, it will also show hide a user with the user ID. So that is what the functionality is doing. Let's go back to the code. And if we now go to the hide the trip and hide the post, they're fairly similar functions. What I do is, in my app context, what is my global context of my application, I have a user, and I add in the property that belongs to the user, a hidden trip, I add the trip ID. I do that so I don't need to re-query the user in the same session. And this just saves me a little bit of database interaction. And at the same time, I call the user repository hide the trip. And this hide the trip will then call hide entity hidden trips. And it writes the record in the data store as we can see it here. So it actually writes this hidden post with the ID. Now, a Firestore document can contain 1 megabyte, so I can actually store quite a few over here. And when I reach that limit, and so far I haven't reached it yet with the iOS application that is already available, I will deal with it and probably make it into a sub-collection or something. But for now, that's not relevant yet. So that is what this function does here on the user repository to write those database records. And all that is left, so for the trip and for the user, it's actually the same kind of functionality. And the only thing left to do now is to make sure when we retrieve data that we filter out those that are blocked. And for that, it gets a little bit more complicated. So let's go and get the trip, the repository, of course. The trips repository is a good example here. Now, for instance, if I go to the function where I get the posts, this is the easiest to understand and do. So this is actually the function where I retrieve the post for a particular trip. Get the trip post. Now, the first thing I do, checking on my app context that knows that as a function is hidden, and all it does is it returns the user, what is part of the logged in user, with their hidden trips or their hidden users, contains the ID that I want to check for. Now, if that is so, if the whole trip has been hidden, I just return an empty data set. So I don't need to query the database anything, I can just return empty posts because the trip is hidden anyway. Now, if that is not the case, I retrieve my posts here for each post. I create the post and now I start checking on each individual post and the user of the post whether it's hidden. If that is not the case, so it's not hidden, so the post is not hidden, the user is not hidden, then I add it to the list and I get my list. And this way, by filtering it out in my repository functions, the rest of the application doesn't need to deal with it, and it always works. And so what I implemented here, I also implemented in some other functions where I get data, for instance, here on top, where I get the trips or the user. That's the first screen you see when you log in. The same thing, if the user is hidden, it's of course no data. And in the other situation, I get the trip user records. If the trip is hidden, or if it's not hidden, there's a not here, it's not very visible, but it's not hidden, then we add it to the users collection that is shown on the screen. Now you've seen that we have a fairly simple implementation of this. So what we did in the user interface, we show the options that the user can choose for flagging and for hiding posts and blocking users. And the content of that, so the options to choose from, are centrally defined in our business logic object. Now, if we choose one of the options, also the business logic object, the block, takes care of that, and it writes information into the data store. And all the information about hidden users, hidden trips, and hidden posts are stored centrally into the user that is signed into the application. And lastly, we use the app context that contains the logged in user to check if data is actually blocked or hidden. So we retrieve it through the data repository objects, and they will use the app context to check if the information should be shown on the screen as well. So it's all nicely centrally organized. And that makes the implementation simple and also easy to implement throughout the rest of the applications. So if we have other screens where we show trips and users, we don't need to worry about blocked users and posts because it's already centrally dealt with in the repository objects. Now, I hope you liked this video. If you like it, please like and subscribe. And be nice to me. Check out the description blocks below for some of the social media accounts. I thank you for watching and I'll see you in the next episode.